My friend, I'm so glad that you are here. I had a message literally burning in my bones that I preached to our congregation entitled, Jesus is Enough. So I want you to get ready. We're going to get into that message together right now. If you got a Bible, turn to Colossians chapter 2 and verse 1 and get ready. We're going to be talking about Jesus and the fact that He is enough. Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you, He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers. Come now to chapter 2 and verse 1. And Paul writes this, he said, "For I want you to know what great conflict I have for you and those in Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh." The word conflict is agon, the Greek word. It's where we get our English word agony. He said, I've had not just a conflict, but a great conflict. I've been in great agony, an agonizing struggle. I've been fighting a hard battle for the believers in these cities. But wait a minute. When Paul wrote this letter, he was in a Roman prison. What kind of a battle, what kind of an agonizing struggle is he having for these churches of Laodicea, Hierapolis, and Colossae? Well, it was an agonizing struggle in prayer. You know, the Living Bible, just like the Message Bible, and you many of you have one or both of those, they are not translations per se, they're paraphrases. What they attempt to do is not to translate the scripture word for word, but they say, okay, we're going to translate ideas and thoughts. That if Jesus or Paul or Peter what they're trying to communicate, what they said in their day, if we were to say that today, how would we capture that? How would we express that thought? And that's what a paraphrase does. I'd like to read to you Colossians 2 and 1 from the Living Bible, because a number of the verses that we're going to deal with today, the Living Bible, the paraphrase, actually got it exactly right. The Living Bible says this, "I wish you could know how much I have struggled in prayer for you and for the churches at Laodicea, or the church at Laodicea, and for my many other friends who have never known me personally." He wrestled for them in prayer, which is no small thing. Don't ever say, well, all we can do is pray. Now, James 5:16 says, "The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much." Not little, avails much. The Amplified Bible says this, that it makes tremendous power available, dynamic in its working. Prayer. You know, Teal Osborne, some of you may know the name, some of you may not. He used to speak at Cottonwood fairly often. He was a great missionary evangelist back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and on into the beginning of the 80s. He held massive salvation healing campaigns around the world, throughout Africa, just about every African nation, throughout Asia, throughout Europe. And still, when I travel today in different regions of the world, I meet people that were saved in T.L. Osborne crusades, or people whose lives were impacted. In fact, I remember I was in the Netherlands spending the day with Brother Andrew. And if you've never read the book, God's Smuggler, you should read it. It's about him. And I was spending the day with Brother Andrew and a friend of his, and his friend's telling me the story of when T.L. was holding a campaign in the Hague many years before. He said, "I was in the back of the crowd. I was a nominal Christian. And there was a man sitting by me, was completely blind, stone blind." He says, "When T.L. Osborne prayed the mass healing prayer, the man's eyes opened up right in front of me." He said, "I spent the whole night crying and walking the streets of my city and praying." He said, it opened up a whole new world to me and changed my life. So TL would have these amazing crusades, 50,000, 100,000, 150,000 people. And I was listening to the man, I think his title was crusade director, it was his son-in-law that did this for him for a period of time. He would have to go into these countries, whether it was, you know, in Indonesia or, you know, somewhere in India, or it might be in Europe or in some African nation. He had to go in ahead of time and secure the stadium or the you know, 50-acre, you know, plot of ground where they could have an outdoor crusade. He had to arrange for all of the sound equipment and the staging and do his best to get the churches to work together. But he said there was always language barriers. He said, I had to meet city officials. Many of them wanted bribes. There was all sorts of opposition. And he said, so many times, you know, we'd be trying to make this thing happen and we would hit an impasse. Barriers that we could not get around, and it just looked like the crusade wasn't going to happen. And I still remember to this day what he said. He said, invariably, I would end up back at my hotel room on my knees, agonizing in prayer, and God would always make a way. He would always open up a way where there was no way. You know, in Romans, it says the Holy Spirit will help us to intercede when that kind of praying is necessary. Let me read the verse to you, Romans 8:26. Likewise, the Spirit also helps our infirmities, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. The Spirit helps our infirmities. The word weaknesses. The word weakness, it's also translated infirmity, but it basically boils down to this, that because of my weakness, I have an inability to produce results. I can't deal with the problem. It's too big. It's too complex. I don't have the strength. I don't have the resource. I cannot handle this. And it says the Spirit helps us. And the word help there, it's actually a triple compound word in the Greek. Three thoughts. First thought is to take hold. Second thought, together with. Third thought, against. To take hold, together with, against. That's what that word literally means. Where it says the Spirit will help us. See this piano up here. All right, let's say I have to have this moved from this side of the stage to the other. It has to be moved. It's my job to move it, and I can't. I do not have the strength. But if I get four or five strong men out here, they'll take hold together with me against the weight of this piano, and then it can be moved, something I couldn't do on my own. The Holy Spirit will do the same thing. Whether it's a family situation, a national situation, a health situation, when we don't know what to pray for as we are, when we don't have the strength, he will take hold together with us against our inabilities to produce results, and he will see that thing is moved. He will see that that thing is done. Paul said, I have this great struggle in prayer for you. Now, what was Paul after as he struggled in prayer? What did he pray as he agonized over these believers in the Lycus Valley? Well, I'm just going to keep reading for the next few verses from the Living Bible as we move on. Verse 2. This is what I've asked of God for you, that you will be encouraged and knit together by strong ties of love, and that you will have the rich experience of knowing Christ with real certainty and clear understanding. For God's secret plan, now at last made known, is Christ himself. In him lie hidden all the mighty untapped treasures of wisdom and knowledge. All right, he asked God for three things for them. Number one, that they would be encouraged. That's a Greek word that historically is used to put the fight back into a soldier that has been discouraged. It's the prayer for a person facing a difficult situation to become courageous in God. You know, Jesus told Peter, he said, Peter, look, Satan has desired to sift you like wheat, but I've prayed for you that your faith would not fail. It's the same idea. The second thing he prayed was for unity among them. He prayed that they would be knit together by strong ties of love. Did you know love is the most unifying force in the world? Even more than agreement. Love is more important to unity than agreement is. Now, agreement's important. And you know, as believers, obviously, we need to have agreement when it comes to the major things. If we're going to walk in unity, the deity of Christ, we have to have agreement there. The sacrificial death of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus, the reality of heaven, the reality of hell. If you don't agree concerning those things, we're not going to have fellowship. There's not going to be unity with us. But when it comes to the minor things, all right, you believe in a mid-trib, you know, rapture of the church. I believe in a pre-tribulation rapture of the church. We can get along. You know, one of us is going to be right, one of us is going to be wrong. We'll find out. Let's go win some souls. Let's worship together. We can have unity. We can walk in love. You know, when it comes to what day to worship on, I have a friend who's got a great church, soul-winning church. They pray for the sick, but he is convinced that Saturday is the day to gather on. Well, our main gatherings are on Sunday. But you know what? I have great fellowship with this guy. He's a friend. There's nothing weird about it. You know, we agree on the major things. I happen to think every day is the same, that it really doesn't. Sunday's great, but I think it'd be just fine if we gathered on Monday. That's my heart. That's where I'm at. He says, fine, Bayless, I think Saturday's the day. I said, great. Good for you. But by contrast, I remember I got on a plane one day. Person next to me, you know, I struck up a conversation and they said, what do you do? I said, oh, I'm a pastor. First question, what day do you gather on? When they found out it wasn't Saturday, man, they lit into me, wanted to pick a fight. It escalated. I had to shut it down. I said, look, we're done talking. I'm sorry. But just immediate, you know, division on their part. Listen, if you're going to create division and be hostile to a blood-washed brother or sister because they voted for someone different than you, you're better than that. You're better than that. The third thing he prayed, that they would be assured that Jesus was enough. Let me pick it up again from the middle of verse 2. And that you will have the rich experience of knowing Christ with real certainty and clear understanding. For God's secret plan, now at last made known, is Christ himself. In him lie hidden all the mighty untapped treasures of wisdom and knowledge. But those treasures of wisdom and knowledge, it said they're hidden in him. It's not like chunks of gold, you know, gold nuggets on the surface that you can just pick up casually with no effort. We need to press in and dig down in our relationship with him. You know, there's different levels of knowing a person. There are a lot of people here today. We recognize one another. I see you, you see me, it's like, hey. Okay. You go to church, I go to church. We don't know much about each other, but you say, yeah, I know him, I know her. There's other people. I know your name. You know my name. You know my kids' names. And I might know a little bit about you. We've had some conversations. And then there's other people that know me much better. They've got a nickname for me, and I got a nickname for them. And they know what I like and what I don't like and what I do and what I don't do. And then there's Janet, my wife. She knows me better than anyone. But there's still more to know about Bayless Conley. But those are all different levels of knowing me. Well, friend, there are endless levels of knowing Jesus. Endless. In verse 4, he said, I'm saying this because I'm afraid that someone may fool you with smooth talk. In other words, saying that Jesus alone is insufficient if you want to experience the deeper things of God. Let me read on. These verses will be on the screen. Pay attention to them. I want to read verses 5 to 10. He said, for though I am far away from you, my heart is with you. Happy because you're getting along so well. Happy because of your strong faith in Christ. Overall, the church was doing quite well. Verse 6, And now, just as you trusted Christ to save you, trust him too for each day's problems. Live in vital union with him. Let your roots grow down into him and draw up nourishment from him. See that you go on growing in the Lord and become strong and vigorous in the truth you were taught. Let your lives overflow with joy and thanksgiving for all he has done. Don't let others spoil your faith and joy with their philosophies, their wrong and shallow answers built on men's thoughts and ideas instead of on what Christ has said. For in Christ, there is all of God in a human body. So you have everything when you have Christ. And you are filled with God through your union with Christ. He is the highest ruler with authority over every other power. My friend, in Christ, in Jesus, dwells the fullness of God. All of God in a human body. He is a river with no banks that has no beginning and no end. He is a sea with no shores. He spans the heavens with the palm of his hand, and he spoke creation into existence with his words. And you want something deeper? You say you had a revelation from an angel. He made the angels. He is the highest ruling authority. And you ask, all right, how could someone fall away or be led astray from Jesus and from the truth of the gospel? Well, he gives two reasons here. The first one, they're fooled with smooth talk. Literally means they've been beguiled with smooth talk, just like the serpent did to Eve in the Garden of Eden. Romans 16, verses 17 and 18 says this, "Now I urge you, brethren, note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned, and avoid them. For those who are such do not serve our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by smooth words and flattering speech deceive the hearts of the simple." By avoiding them, you avoid their smooth speech and flattering words. You know, that's just what the devil did in the garden. There's Eve. Serpent's talking to her and says, "Hey, you can be just like God. You can have this special knowledge. Eve, you have so much potential." Flattery. Listen, flattery is a lot like perfume. Smells great, but you better not swallow it. Man came to me some time ago, been saved here at Cottonwood Church. Had his life changed here. I know a bit about him, knew his story. Amazing story of redemption. But he came to me some time ago and said he had received some special insight. And now he and the other select few were part of an elite remnant. And that my relationship with Jesus as it stands now was not enough. I had not been initiated into the secret knowledge that he had. Now listen, this is not Colossae 2,000 years ago. This is Cottonwood today, deceived. You know, in 1 Timothy 4, Paul said, "In the last days, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of demons." Some will depart from the faith, giving heed. The deception starts when you give heed. When you begin to listen to things that you know are wrong, it gives a seducing spirit access to your mind, and suddenly that which you previously knew to be wrong now begins to appeal to you and suddenly makes sense. Proverbs 19:27, the Living Bible says, "Stop listening to teaching that contradicts what you know is right." So the first way people get led astray, fall away from Christ, is they give heed to smooth, flattering talk. Second reason is because of a failure to become deeply rooted in their personal relationship with Jesus. We read in verse 7, to let your roots go down into him, Jesus. Everybody say him. Let your roots go down into him. Draw up nourishment from him. In verse 6, he said, live in vital union with him. We need to press in and dig deeper and get to know him more through prayerfully spending time in his word, through spending time on our knees in prayer, and by hanging out with people that know him better than we do. Jesus said these words in Luke chapter 6. Whoever comes to me, hears my sayings and does them, I'll show you who he's like. He's like a man building a house who dug deep. Everybody say, dug deep. He's not talking about something shallow here. Built his house and he dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. When the flood arose, stream beat vehemently against the house, could not shake it, for it was founded on the rock. Jesus is talking about relationship here. He said, whoever comes to me and hears and listens, and then does what I say, puts into practice, you come to him. Jesus wants you to come to him, to get on your knees and open your Bible. Say, Lord, speak to me, and to pray, to come to him and to listen. And then to do. And when you do that, your roots begin to go down deeper and deeper as you daily live in vital union with him. I'm coming. Jesus, I'm here. I don't feel like you're anywhere in the room, but I'm here. And I'm going to read your word, and I'm going to worship you, and I'm going to talk to you, and I'm going to listen. And Jesus uses this analogy. It's like this guy that built his house on the rock. There are some people that are rooted in the social aspects of church, which is good. We need people. We are social creatures. We need community. But that alone cannot bring you to spiritual maturity. For those whose roots are primarily there, when the storm comes, they are not likely to survive. We move on, verse 11, and I want to read this from the New King James. He said, in him you were also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the sins of the flesh, by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, in which you also were raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. Now he uses two illustrations here to describe our new life in Christ. One is circumcision. In circumcision, it cuts away a part of the flesh and removes it. And basically, when you believed in Christ, the entirety of your sinful nature was cut away. That is, in your spirit, you became a new creation in Christ. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians that that new person on the inside is created in righteousness and true holiness. The Old Testament puts it this way, God's going to take that heart of stone out of you and put a heart of flesh in you. There's a complete transformation that's so radical, Jesus called it being born again. The second illustration he uses is baptism. In baptism, we're identifying with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. When I go under the waters of baptism, I'm saying, hey, the old Bayless, dead and buried. My old life is gone. When I come up, I identify with Christ. I have a new life. I'm a new man, resurrected on the inside, just like Jesus was resurrected. And if my family and friends want to watch, let them watch. If all of heaven wants to hang over the banisters and watch, let him watch. If every demon in hell wants to watch, let him watch. I belong to Jesus. The old Bayless is gone. I have a new life. Baptism is a declaration of that. Now, we're actually going to dig a bit deeper into these verses next week. You're going to have to put up with me again. And we're going to talk about how to bring what God has put on the inside to the outside. And to live it out. But for now, let's just look at the next two verses, and I'm going to end with these. Verse 13, and you, being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he's made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. He wiped out the handwriting of the requirements that was against us. Literally refers to a written document listing all of our crimes, all of our infractions, all of our rebellion. It was a record of every law of God that I had broken with my heart and with my hands. Inwardly and outwardly, every transgression, everything I'd failed to do, I had nothing in my heart, nothing in my hands to make it right. But you know, as Pontius Pilate had that placard nailed above the head of Jesus on the cross, it said, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. At the same time, there was a pair of invisible hands nailing another placard onto that cross, listing all of my sins. And by so doing, he took my sin out of the way. He wiped them out and he removed them. Every sin against heaven, everything that I had done wrong, every transgression, God nailed it to the cross. And I love that. It says that he wiped it out. That literally means that he erased it completely. No more record. That's what the Greek means. You know, I use my little calendar on my phone quite a bit. But I'm still a bit old school. You know, I hate doing updates. You know, I shut my phone off at night and I don't let them happen. So I'm always having to ask, well, the grandkids are not around now, but I was always having to ask my grandkids, how do I do this? But when it comes to my calendar, I have this big, giant calendar that I lay out. It's coated with clear plastic. Takes up almost the whole table. Put a coffee cup in each corner, and I've got a green marker and a red marker and a black marker. And I put in every time I'm preaching at Cottonwood, every trip I've got where I'm preaching around the world, family vacation. Oh, I got to take a fishing trip here. And I put everything on the counter. And when I mess up, and sometimes I do, you know what I do? I just get a paper towel, put a little water on it, and I wipe it off, and my mistake disappears. You don't know what it was. You can't find out what it was because it's gone. That's what happened to my sins when Jesus died on the cross. It's gone. It's been erased. Isn't that wonderful? He doesn't just cover our sins like under the Old Testament, but he erases them. He eradicates them. As far as the East is from the West, so far he removes our transgressions from us. And my friend, the East and the West never touch. Marvelous, marvelous. Now, when it comes to human beings, let's say that I offended you, that I did something to hurt you, and then I came to Christ and got saved, my sins have been washed away. All right, heaven's ledger, I got a clean slate. I may need to sort some things out with you. I realize that. Restitution may need to happen, you know, on a level here, because you're still hurt, I still owe you, whatever it might be. Sometimes we just need to work those things out as human beings. But from God's ledger, from heaven's viewpoint, our sins are eradicated. They are wiped out forever and ever. Thank you, Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
We've all made mistakes. Too many times we let those failures define the way we live. We let the disappointments of the past shape our future. You don't have to let your past define you. It's time to turn those mistakes into miracles. In Bayless Conley's inspiring booklet, Turning Mistakes into Miracles, you'll discover the essential principles needed to overcome yesterday's failures and move forward into your purpose and destiny. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com, you'll learn how to rely on God in times of trouble, how to recover from tragedy, and how to find peace in God's love, available in physical, digital, or audiobook formats for just $12. Turning Mistakes into Miracles will inspire and challenge you to live the life you were created for. No matter what you have experienced in your past, everyone has made mistakes. But oftentimes we allow our past, people, or even pride to discourage us from pursuing God's plan. When you go online to BaylessConley.com and get the book Turning Mistakes into Miracles, you will learn the spiritual truths and practical steps to move forward in your life. You will understand, with God, all things are possible. Don't let your past define you. Go online right now to BaylessConley.com to get Turning Mistakes into Miracles. That's BaylessConley.com. Go online right now.
We're uploading new content every week to help you find answers for your life. So don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. In the comments, let us know how this teaching encouraged you. We'd love to hear from you. Our prayer is that God's richest and best be yours always.